So hello everyone, my name is Wolfgang Hankeln and I'm sitting here with Dawn Field. This is now the third day of the GSC 14 meeting. Mm-hmm. We are almost done. So please, could you introduce yourself once again as the organizer of the GSC 14 meeting?
Right, yeah. So I'm Dawn Field and I'm from the Centre of Ecology and Hydrology in the UK and also part of the University of Oxford. And yeah, it's been my real pleasure to be one of the organizers for GSC 14 and also the launch of the GOES Network, Genomic Observatories Network. And it's just the end of the meeting, so we're a bit on a high from having had a successful, fun meeting.
Yes, well done,
for sure. Yeah, thank you. It's the work of many, many, many people.
So maybe can you, for those who are maybe not familiar with the GSC, explain in general, what is the contribution to a wider community?
Right, yeah. So the GSC, obviously genomics is a growth field now. Lots of people are generating data from sort of all corners. And we became interested in how you provide stewardship over the entire collection. So working with the primary public databases and key bioinformatics centers, we wanted to try to get more contextual information about genomes so that you could help underpin downstream comparative studies. And so that's how the GSC formed. And of course, now we've had 14 meetings. We have a lot of activities going on. And hopefully we're becoming a voice for the community about where these kinds of standardization activities can happen. A lot of people think standards are quite the dry thing, but we try to think of them more as innovation tools, that if you don't have to worry about certain things working well, you can actually get on to the real science.
So this has, as you already mentioned, been the 14th meeting of the GSC.
Yeah.
What were the main themes? You already mentioned the GOES initiative.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So the GSC has a diversity of projects. And each meeting has a very different theme, and this one was really about trying to form this genomic observatories network, so having this marriage between long-term research sites and the genomics community, specifically highlighting some of these pillars of the community sites that are already doing both. So looking at genomic information in the context of you know, decades of past environmental and ecological evolutionary biodiversity data. So we brought together candidate genomic observatory sites, partners of those sites, and key members of the GSC community, and also key members of the Ocean Sampling Day initiative, to sort of talk about how we might come together and share best practice and actually formalize a real network that can work together.
So, and if you put it in your words, what is a genomic observatory?
What is a genomic observatory? Right. So I think many of us, when you think observatory, you think of radio telescopes, you think of, you know, looking at the stars. Those are long infrastructures you look for a long time. And the analogy with astronomy is actually quite good. If you looked out at the night sky one day, you might just think there's a bunch of twinkling in the sky. You wouldn't actually understand, you know, planets. You wouldn't see the motion, the process. That's something you have to observe over time. And I think we're just getting enough capacity with genomics to move into actually looking over time so you can have these sustained views. So by analogy, a genomic observatory then would make sustained genomic views so we can see how biodiversity is changing, how it might be lost, how it might function. That would be a genomic observatory.
So if I'm a scientist now, what's the benefit in taking part in this initiative?
Right. Well, hopefully there's several benefits to the network. There are lots of premier sites. There's a lot of pooled expertise. So if you join, you immediately have contact with a lot of colleagues around the world. And there's also, it opens up scope because there are so many groups coming together to design and execute new types of studies, like Ocean Sampling Day, because you use a wide variety of sites. So I think a lot of people are looking in the first instance to sort of accelerate what they're already doing, maybe profile where their expertise is. But in the longer run, like all networks, you benefit from being part of a group. As we heard in the meeting, no one group can do every technology, can look at every taxonomic group, can study every system. But more as a network, you start to get better coverage. And if we come together as a network, then we can start thinking about doing things together. So the long-term goal that still has to be realized is what could we achieve long-term.
So it's a joint global effort, as you already mentioned. Mm. And if you are compiling this huge data set in a consistent and global scale way, what can you do with this data in the end? What are the questions
right.
that you can answer?
Right. So in the first case, it sounds like we would know exactly what data we have, but actually some of the first steps are trying to figure out what data we have. Even on some of the sites, they do so much rich research. You know, there's not one website that lists everything, although a lot of them are coming along. So the first thing is to figure out what could you do with the data that's there, and how could you design future experiments. But these are the kinds of sites that are already studied because they're models of something, biodiversity or a particular process, a terrestrial system. So there are many local questions that we can look up for, and you can replicate across sites. But some of the examples are, for example, microbial function in the marine domain. We want to know how microbes contribute to photosynthesis, so oxygen, how much carbon we're sinking and how much oxygen we're producing. There are lots of questions in and around biodiversity. I think a lot of people are very interested in moving beyond the species level to communities, so how species interact. And we're just tooling up to actually consider some of these questions.
This also connects to like these issues of global change and climate change and also human impact on the ecosystem.
Yeah.
Would you say that this is also a good way to monitor human impact and change on a global scale?
Absolutely, absolutely. So one of the things that we need to monitor change is a baseline. You need these extended observations so that you can see changes in the observations. We don't really have that yet in a lot of places. So the places that we're looking at now are sort of a mix of some of the most pristine sites on Earth, which are quite rare, they're still quite unusual, down to ones that are highly impacted, so we can look at a range of questions. But again, it's sort of another layer of monitoring what's going on the Earth.
You already said there are a lot of existing LTERs, and they already have infrastructure.
Yeah.
How are you planning to integrate these GOES infrastructures into already existing infrastructures?
Absolutely, absolutely. So the sites that have joined so far all have champions, genomics champions. And we're very careful that the GOES network is not reinventing the wheel, that it's trying to draw from these other networks. So we're very much both bringing genomics online and sort of layering it into the existing infrastructure. And so we hope to be sort of a cross-network pooled site. And we have some sites that are absolutely leading in genomics and happen to be at a long-term research site. And then we have other large networks where maybe there's only one or two genomics champions who are saying, we've got all this fantastic contextual data. What if we put in a genomics layer? And I think the thing that's becoming really attractive is for those of us who do DNA-level observations, if you're going to go out and ask a question like, how do communities change over time, you want to do it in the best contextualized site that you can. And some of these studies have been sites have been studied for decades. You might as well invest your time and effort there if it fits your question.
All right, coming now to the OSD, could you maybe explain what is this Ocean Sampling Day all about?
Yeah, so Ocean Sampling Day is part of an EU-funded project called MicroB3, which is biodiversity, bioinformatics, and biotechnology for marine informatics. And as part of that, we wanted to coordinate a global sampling campaign of the world's oceans to look at microbes, so the invisible component. But as we know, it's a huge part of biodiversity. It's largely been unstudied so far, and it provides a lot of our essential ecosystem services, so cleaning the water. And we thought it wouldn't start till 2014, but there was so much uptake, especially as we started talking to sites in this genomic observatories network, that we decided to run a pilot this summer solstice. And so we were just sort of learning how to go forward on this, but we'll scale up on 2014, hopefully to an international sampling of the world's oceans. And then once we know what's happening on one day, we can make sort of a microbial weather map and figure out what the function of the world's oceans look like, as much as we can extrapolate from that data, and hopefully get up towards predictive models.
And you think with the data that you compile during the Ocean Sampling Day, can you already answer some of the urgent scientific questions that are out there?
We're still exploring, and a lot of this depends on which sites come online. For example, what kind of geographic distributions we have. We're looking across latitudinal gradients. In the end, we'll have to optimize funding versus where we can sample. But one of our main questions that we're trying to ask is, we've observed in the Western English Channel that there's a dip and a peak in bacterial diversity, and we'd like to know if this is a global phenomenon. We think it's related to day length. So that'll be one of the questions. But you can use this data to go back and ask some of these sort of long-standing questions. Is everything everywhere? Is there a latitudinal gradient in richness? There are many, many questions, and we hope to make the data as open as possible so people can mine it in different ways.
So why is the Ocean Sampling Day important at all? I mean,
Right. So it sort of has two roles. In one way, a lot of metagenomics, a lot of genomics is hypothesis seeking. You look at a lot of new data and you look at the world in a different way, and you find things that then you test. So it's sort of an exploratory path, a discovery path. So we're using it in part like that. And for example, some of the applications will be new genes that might go towards the green economy. So that's the biotechnology end of MicroB3. So it could be a novel enzyme for a function that, changes industry or medicine, for example. And on the other hand, testing some of these long-standing questions, because this is actually one of the first mega sequencing projects to be done simultaneously. And we can only do that on one day that everybody goes out with so much collaborative work. It'll be a new view that corrects for seasonality and for time.
So do you think there are ways where you can also involve the public, not only the scientific community? And why is the OSD important in that respect?
Right. So as we start to envision how this goes, if we're deciding on shared practices and we tell that to the different labs who are involved, it's only one step further as a natural progression to say, well, if we got it down to something easy, a kit or a, you know, and you're just scooping a water sample, process it in a certain uniform way, why couldn't you give it to a boat? Why couldn't you have people who are out on the water in different places actually be engaged? And then it would take on a citizen science dimension. So if all goes well, we can easily imagine that happening, and we're already getting inquiries about it. We have till 2014 to see if that's viable. It largely, this has grown so quickly, much bigger than we thought it would be. It's going to depend on people coming forward and how much help we get, really. So we're very keen to encourage participation.
All right, so I covered all the questions I had on my list. Is there something you would like to add that I missed, maybe?
Yeah, because this is the closing day of GSC 14, it's just to give huge thanks to everybody who participated. This was very much sort of a vision of particular people, of the organizers, of the sponsors, but of all the genomic observatories that came in. And this network will be, you know, what people contribute and what they put into it in the future. And if these 3 days are an indication of what could happen, I'm very, very hopeful. So thank you.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.